Okay, let's start. Last lesson, we have learned the compensatory response in heart failure. This compensatory response include cardiac compensation and systemic compensations. And we also reviewed the normal histology of myocardium. So next. continue to learn the mechanism for pathogenesis of heart failure. At first, I have a question. What's the excitation contraction coupling? In other words, how the myocardial cell contract and delay. Remember? The process of excitation or contraction coupling is a process by which electrical action threshold leading to the construction of cardiac muscle cells, right? Yeah. Look at slides. The catecholamines are released by neurons, and catecholamines binding to beta-1 adrenergic receptor, then a series of G protein mediated changes leading to the activation of CNP. CNP further activate PKA. Yeah, PKA. PKA can phosphorylate the calcium channel in the myocardial cell membrane, right? Right? No? Understand? No? Repeat? Okay. When catecholamines are released by neuron, catecholamines bind to beta-1 adrenergic receptor. Then a series of G protein mediate the changes leading to the activation of CAMP is a signal pathway. Okay? CAMP activate PKA, protein kinase A. Protein kinase A can phosphorylate calcium channel in the myocardial cell membrane. Phosphorylate is a protein post-translation modification of protein, okay? Can phosphorylate calcium channel in the myocardial cell membrane. As a result, a small portion of calcium is transported into cell. Then, this concentration of the calcium in the cytoplasm increase, right? Further promote the release of calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum. Yes or no? Can be a response. Okay. The next calcium combined with troponin. Okay? Troponin. Calcium combined with troponin. So the binding site of morphine to actin is disposed. So sin and the sin fragments interact each other. So in this condition, the ATPase in the morphine header can hydrolyze the ATP to produce the energy for a filament slide, okay, to complete the construction of Markov cell. Yes or no? The process of excitation contracts coupling, we should learn in the physiology. Yeah? Yeah. Okay, this is the contraction of Markov cell. Look at the flies. Okay, this is actin, this is morphine. And when calcium, the concentration of calcium in the cell increase, so binding to troponin. So the binding site for morphine in the actin is deposed. So morphine binding to actin. Okay, then the ATPase hydrolyze ATP to produce energy for the stack of filament. Okay? Okay, when repolarization happens in the Markov cell, most of calcium are uptaken by sarcoplasmic reticulum, and a small portion of calcium are transported outside by membrane calcium ATPase and sodium calcium exchanger. So the concentration of calcium in the cell decreases, right? Yes or no? The calcium transported, a small portion of calcium is transported outside, and then most of calcium is re-uptaken by sarcoplasmic reticulum. So the concentration of calcium in the cell decreases. So in this condition, the calcium dissociated from troponin. Right, so the bonding site of morphine in actin is recovered, is covered again, right? So the myocardial cell begin to dilate. Okay, this is the excitation contraction coupling. So here, I have a question. What are the basic requirements for the myocardial contraction and relaxation? Calcium. Yeah, calcium is very important ion for the contraction or relaxation, right? Yeah, calcium. Wow, first factor. ATP, yeah, very good, ATP. Because energy is very important. Yeah, ATP. Other things? Yeah, very good. The first normal function of contractile and regulatory proteins. We know delays process, morphine, actin, troponin, tropomyosin participate in the excitation contraction coupling, right? So this is the basic, this is the first basic requirement for contraction and relaxation. Another is the normal calcium transportations. Yeah. The next is the normal mercury and energy metabolism. So any etiologic factors affecting these basic requirements can result in heart failure. So far, the pathogenesis of heart failure is not fully elucidated. Currently, the pathogenesis of heart failure is believed to associate with following mechanism. The first is depressed myocardial contractility. Another is this diastolic dysfunction and disharmony between systole and diastole. Okay, now we will study these mechanisms in detail. Depressed myocardial contractility is the main reason for the decreased myocardial cell. Depressed myocardial contractility is the main reason for the decreased heart pump function. Yeah. Depressed myocardial contractility is associated with the following reasons. The first, the injury of myocardial contractile protein. Another is energy metabolism that's function of myocardium. The third one, dysfunction of excitation contraction coupling. This part is very important. So look at slides. A variety of etiologic factors can lead to myocardial cell degeneration, atrophy, and even myocardial cell dies, such as the severe hypoxia, ischemia can destroy the myocardial cell, so lead to the rupture of the lysosome. We know in the lysosome there are a lot of lysosome enzyme, right? When these enzymes are released into the cell, leading to the autolysis, okay? The further leading to the cell dies. The cell dies, there are two kinds of cell dies. One is called necrosis, another is apoptosis. So a large number of myocardial cells die. So the contractile protein injured, right? Yeah. So myocardial contractility decrease. So stall volume decrease, cardiac output decrease, leading to heart failure, right? So in clinical medicine, severe myocardial infection is the most common cause for the necrosis of myocardial cell. Except for the myocardial cell, except for the necrosis of myocardial cell in the central zone, central area of the ischemic myocardium, there are some researchers found apoptosis of myocardial cell in the marginal zone. Such as this is the ischemic cardiac muscle. In the central zone, there are necrosis of myocardial cell. But in the marginal zone, there are some apoptosis of myocardial cell can be found. Okay, understand? Yeah. And some research found the decreased number of myocardial cell caused by the apoptosis is a major cause for the heart failure in the elderly people. Okay? Yeah. Apoptosis causes the decreased number of myocardial cells, which is the main reason for the heart failure in the elderly people. Okay? What's the problem? Okay. If you're interested in this area, you can browse this article in the SBI, okay? SBI, yeah. You know, do you know SBI? Is that database or American reference, public article, SBI. we know normal energy metabolism in heart is very important for heart pump function. In normal condition, the energy metabolism in heart has three parts. The first is energy generation, energy storage, and energy utilization. Energy generation means a variety of nutrients are converted to acetyl coenzyme A. Acetyl coenzyme A turns into Krebs cycle that produce ATP. Okay, it's the process of energy generation. The process of energy storage means look at this. Under the action of creatine kinase. The creatine transform into creatine phosphate. In this process, ATP or energy can be stored in the heart muscle cell. The heart muscle cell needs energy to contract. This energy. Is released. Okay? Yeah. This is energy storage. The process of energy utilization means the ATP is in the header of mousing, hydrolyze ATP to produce the energy for the filament slide. Okay? So any factors affecting each of these processes can impair energy metabolism in half mass cell, right? So further impair excitation contra coupling and result heart failure happen. In clinical medicine, there are a lot of disease can lead to disorders in energy production. We know the enough blood and oxygen supply is very important for energy production, right? So this and this disease, such as coronary heart disease, shock, anemia, can decrease the blood supply, blood and oxygen supply to heart, right? So energy production in heart decrease, right? So the energy production in heart cell decrease. So myocardial contractility decrease. Moreover, some research found in hypertrophic myocardial tissue, the number and the activity of mitochondria in is relative and in adequate is not enough. We know if the activity of number of mitochondria decrease, so the level of oxidation phosphorylation decrease, right? So the production of energy in heart decrease. Yes, okay. Okay. We know creatine kinase is very important enzyme in the process of energy storage in heart cell, right? Creatine kinase and the exon creatine kinase, creatine transform to creatine phosphate. So in the process, energy will be stored in the heart muscle cell. So in this process, so in the process of energy storage, creating CK, creatine kinase is a very important enzyme, right? Yeah. Creatine kinase is a cytosolic enzyme composed of two subunits, M and B. That's that. So there are three different kinds of isoenzyme, right? CK and M, CK and CK and B, CK double B, right? Three kinds of isoenzyme. CKNN, CKNB are predominantly found in the heart muscle. Researchers found in hypertrophic heart muscle, CKNN, the level of CKNN always decrease, but CKNB always increase. Researcher also found CKNY with higher activity and CKNB with the lower activity. So when CKNN decrease, CKNB increase, so total activity of CK in hypertrophic myocardium decrease, right? This one with higher activity, CKNB with a lower activity, but in hypertrophic myocardium, the level of CKNN always decrease, but CKNB is always upregulated. So total activity of CK decrease. So the energy storage in heart muscle decrease. Okay? Yeah. We know ATPase in the morphine is very important. It's another important enzyme because this enzyme can hydrolyze ATP to produce the energy for filament slide, right? In hypertrophic myocardium, the activity of this enzyme also decrease. So the energy utilization for myocardial contraction will be impaired. So cardiac contractility decrease, right? Yes or no? Yes. This part, there are a lot of knowledge, so you may feel there is a little boring, but yeah, even in for the Chinese students. Okay, let's do some exercise. You can have a rest. The most important eye involved in the process of myocardium excitation contraction coupling. C, yeah, calcium. Yeah. The essence of cardiac concentric hypertrophy is concentric. Which one? B, right? B. Sarcomere is added in parallel, not in serial. Which following pathologic condition doesn't occur with cardiac eccentric hypertrophy? We know cardiac eccentric hypertrophy caused by volume overload, right? So which one can cause volume overload? Which of the following pathologic condition doesn't occur with cardiac concentric hypertrophy? Which one? B, right? Because B can cause concentric hypertrophy. Hypertension can cause pressure overload. Cardiac myogenic deletion is characterized by which one? A? Tonogenic deletion can also increase in the diastolic blood volume of ventricle. So this one not good, not answered. C, right? C, because tonogenic deletion tonogenic deletion, the sarcomere loss always below 2.2 micrometer. So with the increased blood volume in the at the end of diastolic period, the myocardial contractility also increase. But in myogenic deletion, the sarcomere loss always smaller than 2.2 micrometer. So myocardial contractility always decrease, to C. Okay, let's continue. Next, we will learn next mechanism for the decreased myocardial contractility is dysfunction of excitation contract coupling. We know in the process of excitation contract coupling, calcium is very important, right? Yeah, to mediate the transfer, conversion from electrical signal to medical activity. So calcium, the normal calcium transportation is very important for excitation contraction coupling. The dysfunction of excitation contract coupling is believed to associate with reduced influx of extracellular calcium. Second, dysfunction of cytoplasmic reticulum handling calcium, and the last dysfunction of calcium binding to troponin. So look at this. We know in the in the process of excitation contracting company, a small portion calcium, a small portion transported into a cell, right? So this small portion of calcium cannot only increase the concentration of calcium in the cell of plasma, but also further promote the release, more release of calcium from sarcoplasmic reticulum, right? So the influx of extracellular calcium is a key step for the myocardial cell contraction, right? So if the influx of extracellular calcium decrease, so the process of excitation contract coupling will be inhibited, right? We know the influx of extracellular calcium depend on the beta receptor signaling pathway, right? Yes or no? Right? When catecholamines binding to beta receptor, then pKa is activity. So pKa can phosphorylate calcium channel in the cell membrane, so leading to the opening of calcium channel. So calcium is transported into cell, right? Yeah. So the influx of extracellular calcium depends on the activation of beta receptor signaling pathway, right? Yeah. Some research found in the hypertrophic myocardial set, the beta receptor density always decreases. That's because the overgrowth of cell membrane in hypertrophic myocardial cell. Okay, so beta receptor density decrease relative. Meanwhile, the quantity of norepinephrine also decrease due to the decline successes of norepinephrine and the enhanced consumption of norepinephrine in hypertrophic myocardium. And acidosis can decrease the sensitivity of beta receptor to catecholamines. This is factor can block beta receptor signal pathway, right? Right? Yeah? Yeah. So these factors can decrease the influx of extracellular calcium into the cell, right? Right? Yeah, so the excitation control coupling will be inhibited. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. besides extracellular calcium, combat these calcium to move into cell plasma in condition such as hyperkalemia. We know potassium, both of potassium and calcium are positive ion, right? Calcium, both of them are positive ion. So potassium can compete with calcium to enter into cell plasma. So hyperkalemia can reduce influx of actual calcium. In the process of myocardial cell contraction, the cytosolic change of calcium is mainly regulated by sarcoplasmic reticulum, right? By three processes. The first is uptaken. The calcium is uptaken by calcium, and the calcium is stored in calcium, and calcium can be released by sarcoplasmic reticulum, right? Yeah. So sarcoplasmic reticulum is very important cell organs. Calcium okay, let's have a right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, let's continue. In heart muscle cell, the calcium is uptaken by sarcoplasmic reticulum, where is sarcoendoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase is a calcium transport ATPase so this the activity of the level of this ATPase is very important for the uptake of calcium in the SR, right? Yeah. But in hypertrophic myocardial cell, the quantity of activity of this ATPase always decrease. So the calcium uptake by SR decrease, right? So the in this condition, the calcium supply for the myocardial cell contraction decrease, right? Uptaken decrease, calcium uptaken decrease. So the calcium relieved by reticulum SR also decrease, right? This one. Uptaken calcium uptaken by SR decrease. So the storage of calcium in SR decrease. So the release of calcium from SR decrease. So calcium used by contraction will be inhibited, right? In hypertrophic, when calcium uptaken by SR decrease, so the concentration of calcium in heart muscle cell cannot drop down to a diastolic threshold. So calcium cannot dissociated from troponin. So myocardial relaxation will be inhibited, right? Yeah. So both of them can affect excitation contract coupling. Ranodide receptor. Look at this one. Ranodide receptor is a calcium release channel for responsible for the release of calcium from SR. This protein also decrease in hypertrophic myocardium, so the release of calcium from SR decrease when heart muscle contract. So the process of excitation contract coupling will be inhibited. Moreover, acidosis is another factor affecting to the is another factor which can lead to the dysfunction of SR handling calcium. That's because hydrogen ion. Hydrogen ion can bind with troponin. The affinity for hydrogen ion to troponin is higher than the affinity between calcium and troponin. So when acidosis happens, the hydrogen ion can inhibit the binding acidosis can increase the affinity of calcium to SR. So the release of calcium from SR will be inhibited. Okay, that's that. The third reason for the dysfunction of excitation contrast coupling is dysfunction of calcium binding to troponin. That's because the affinity of hydrogen ion for troponin is higher than the affinity of hydrogen ion. Acidosis can lead to the dysfunction of calcium binding to troponin. That's because in acidosis, the affinity of for hydrogen ion to troponin is higher than the affinity between calcium to troponin. So the hydrogen ion acidosis can inhibit the combination of calcium to troponin. Okay. So the first mechanism for heart failure is the depressed myocardial contractility, which is composed of the injury of contractile proteins, dysfunction of energy metabolism, and dysfunction of excitation contraction coupling. Okay? Yeah. So this is the first mechanism for heart failure. Another mechanism for heart failure is diastolic dysfunction. Diastolic function. We know in the period of diastole, blood return to heart, right? And ventricle refilling the blood, right? Yeah. So then the blood is pumped from ventricle to peripheral organs. In clinical medicine, there are about 30% of patients with heart failure are caused by the ventricular diastolic dysfunction, especially in elderly patients. The diastolic death function is believed to associated with delayed restoration of calcium. This order of this association of morphine acting complex and decline ventricular complex. Look at that. In the diastolic period, the calcium, the concentration of calcium in the heart muscle cell dropped quickly to a diastolic threshold. Okay? Diastolic threshold, the concentration of calcium in heart muscle cell drop down quickly to a diastolic threshold. So in this condition, the calcium dissociated from troponin. So leading to the disengagement of actin from morphine. So the heart began to dilate, right? In this process, a large amount of calcium reuptaken by SR, and a small portion of calcium is transported outside, right? Both of the transportation of calcium depend on energy, okay? Right? The uptaken calcium by SR depends on circa, this is ATP, this is ATPase, right? A small portion of calcium is transported outside, depend on another calcium pump. So both of the transportation of calcium is energy dependent manner, right? Yeah. So if the energy metabolism in heart muscle is impaired, so the transportation of the calcium will be inhibited, right? Such as this disease, hypertrophy, cardiac ischemia, anemia. This disease can decrease energy supply to heart muscle. So transportation of calcium in heart muscle cell will be inhibited. So in this condition, the concentration of calcium cannot drop down, right, to a diastolic threshold, right? So the restoration of calcium will be inhibited. If the concentration of calcium in heart muscle cell is higher, the calcium cannot be dissociated from troponin. As a result, the actin cannot be dissociated from morphine. So the relaxation of heart muscle cell will be inhibited, right? Yeah. So the process of myocardial cell relaxation will be inhibited. Right? Yeah. So delayed restoration of calcium is the first reason for diastolic dysfunction. But yeah. This engagement or actin from osmin also depends on ATP. So this disease can also lead to dysfunction of this engagement of actin from osmin. Yeah. So the diastolic function of heart muscle will be impaired. The third reason for diastolic dysfunction is declined ventricular compliance. Do you know the ventricle compliance? Look at the video. Look at that. This is this ball. When you press this ball, the ball changes its shape, right? When you take away your hand, the ball tend to recover its original shape, right? In other words, the ball tend to be late, right? So similar with the ball, the heart compliance is after contraction, the heart tend to delete, right? This ability we call it myocardial complex. Okay, the complex is defined as the excitation of elastic tissue under the action of intentional force. Can you understand this definition? When you press the ball changes shape, tend to light, right? Yeah. When you take away your hand, the ball tend to dilate, right? Tend to recover its original state. Okay? So similar with the ball, in the systole period, the heart contract. After contraction, the ventricle tend to dilate, right? Yeah. So this is heart complex. the normal ventricular complex is a very important function for the blood return to heart, right? Complex. The normal function of ventricular complex is very important for the blood return to heart. It's very important for blood refilling of the ventricle, right? Yeah. So if ventricular complex decreases, so the diastolic function of ventricle will be impaired. So blood return to heart decrease, right? So in the systolic period, the blood volume injected by ventricle decrease, right? Yeah. So stroke volume decrease, cardiac output decrease, leading to heart failure. Understand? The following disease can decrease the ventricular complex or increase stiffness, such as ventricular hypertrophy, myocarditis, myocardial fibrosis. Okay? Yeah. So decrease ventricular complex is another reason for the diastolic dysfunction. Okay? Any question? No? Yes or no? No. This is false, right? If you press this ball, this ball chin is sick, right? When you take away your hand, the ball tend to recover its original shape, right? Right? Yeah. Similar with this ball, our heart contract, change its shape, right? Such as this heart contract, change its shape. When finish the contraction, the heart tend to recover its original shape. Right? Tend to be late. So heart complex is excitation of elastic tissue and the action of external force. Yeah. So the ventricular complex is very important for the diastolic function of ventricle, right? The normal function of ventricular complex is very important for the blood return to the ventricle, right? Yeah. So, if ventricular complex depressed, so ventricular filling will decrease. So blood injected by ventricle decrease. So volume decrease, heart output decrease, and heart failure happens. Okay. Ventricular complex. We should learn in physiology. We can review this concept. Okay, let's go on. So diastolic dysfunction is associated with delayed restoration of calcium. the dysfunction of this association of morphine and actin and decrease the ventricular complex. The third mechanism for the pathogenesis of heart failure is disharmony between systole and diastole. We know our heart is a spherical organ with good coordination in each part. So if some factors affecting these coordinations can affect the function of heart, such as the disharmony between the systole and the diastole, can be induced by arrhythmia, regional distribution of lesions, such as myocardial infarction. So in this condition, the heart works in an unsynchronized way, resulting in the disorder of heart pump and decrease cardiac output. Okay? Yeah. So this is the third mechanism for heart failure. Okay, that's the fifth part is very important. Very important one. So when we review this chapter, you should focus on this part. A lot of knowledge, right? A lot of knowledge. So next, I will introduce clinical manifestations. Okay. The symptom of a patient with heart failure is always caused by the decreased cardiac output and the excessive activation of neurohumoral regulations. In clinical medicine, you will find a lot of clinical manifestations of patients with heart failure. But here we only introduce the symptoms caused by the decreased cardiac output and pulmonary and systemic congestion. We know in most of heart failure, the cardiac output always decrease. So next, I will introduce some index with change in the heart failure caused by the decreased cardiac output. The first index is cardiac output. We know cardiac output is a very important index which is commonly used for evaluate cardiac pump function. But this index is determined by several factors such as age, height, and weight. So this index lacks the comparability between the different patients. So in clinical medicine, there is another index to evaluate the pump function in different person. This index is cardiac index index CI. Cardiac index is standard cardiac output by unit body surface. In severe heart failure, both of cardiac output and cardiac index decrease, even at the resting state. Yeah. Okay. Another detects injection pressure. I have introduced this one in last lesson. In Java Python is a ratio of store volume to vertical and diagonal volume. Reflects this index reflects the injection efficiency, right? Yeah. Injection fraction can be look at. Injection fraction can be detected by ultrasonic. You know, ultrasonic is a non-invasive and a convenient method in clinical medicine. Yeah? You know, ultrasonic. the normal value of EF is about 55 to 65% in the resting state. When EF is between 50 to 55, that means the ventricle contraction function is kept at normal level. Between 40 to 50, that means the myocardial systolic function has been impaired mildly. Below 30, that means systolic function is impaired moderately. And below 30, that means systolic function has been impaired severely. But with the understanding of diastolic heart failure, the doctor found the EF always increased in the patient with diastolic heart failure. We know diastolic heart failure means the diastolic function is impaired. So venous return to heart decrease, right? Right? In diastolic heart failure, blood return to heart decrease, right? So and the diastolic volume decrease significantly, right? So EF when and the diastolic volume decrease, so blood volume injected by ventricle also decrease, right? But this one decrease significantly. So EF always increase. EF always increase in the patient with diastolic heart failure. So the diagnosis of heart failure should not depend on the decrease EF completely, right? Because some patient with diastolic heart failure EF increase, not decrease, right? Okay. There are another index which change in the heart failure, such as PAWP and CWP. PAWP means pulmonary artery wrist pressure. Okay? Pulmonary artery wrist pressure. CVP, central venous pressure. PAWP reflects the pressure in the left ventricle and atrium,
at the end of diastole, diastole. Okay, reflect the pressure in the left ventricle and the atrium at the end of diastole period. Okay, yeah, this pressure can be detected by inducing a pulmonary artery catheter with a inflated balloon into a small pulmonary artery. Okay. Central venous pressure, reflect the pressure of the right atrium and the kind of vena. Okay. Can be detected by inducing central venous catheter into the big vein. Yeah. Well, we know in heart failure, the eject fraction always decreases. So, and the diastole volume in ventricle increase, right? Right? Yeah. This one decrease means and the diastole volume always increase, right? So ventricular and the diastole volume pressure increase, and the pressure in atrium also increase. So both of PAWP and CVP also increase. Okay. Because the blood cannot inject by ventricle, so the blood volume at the end of diastole in ventricle increase, right? So venous blood from atrium to ventricle is blocked, so the pressure in atrium increase, right? Yeah, so CVP and PAWP increase. Okay. Yeah. Another index, increase heart rate. We know cardiac output determined by heart rate and slow volume, right? In most of heart failure, slow volume decrease. So cardiac output can be maintained at to a certain level in heart failure. Mainly depends on the increased heart rate, right? That's because stall volume always decreases. So increased heart rate is beneficial to maintain blood cardiac output at to a certain level. And the increased heart rate exists all the process of heart failure. The increased heart failure in the rest state, in the resting state, is not only the clinical manifestation, but also means the body's compensatory response has been initiated. So this is heart rate. But excessive increased heart rate can impair the heart pump function. We have in the last lecture, right? The changes of blood pressure. The changes of blood pressure in heart failure depend on the speed and the severity of heart failure, such as in the severe acute heart failure caused by severe myocardial infarction or severe arrhythmia, severe virus infection, so the body has not enough time to initiate compensatory response, so blood pressure decreases significantly, right? Even lead to cardiogenic shock. But for the chronic heart failure, the body has enough time to initiate the compensatory responses, such as the activation of sympathetic nervous system, right? The increased peripheral resistance, the increased reabsorption sodium and the water from distal tube collect tube, right? This complementary response is beneficial to maintain blood pressure at a relatively normal level. blood redistribution also can happen in heart failure. Blood redistribution rates due to the different response for various vessels to activation of sympathetic nervous system, right? That's because the different concentration of upper receptor in the different organs. The patients with heart failure represents the pale of Lewis and Kautsky. That means the blood flow in skin vessel decrease, right? Yeah, because alpha receptor concentration in skin vessel is high. So when sympathetic nervous system is activity, so the vessel in the skin constrict, so blood volume in the skin decrease. So the patient may represent the pale of Lewis and cold skin. And fatty, that means the blood volume in the skeletal muscle decrease. And the mental confusion, severe heart failure can cause the decrease the blood flow in the brain. So patient may represent mental confusion. Less urine volume. That means the blood flow in the kidney decrease, right? Okay, that's the symptom caused by the decline of the cardiac output. So next, I will introduce the pulmonary congestion and the systemic venous congestion. Systemic circulation congestion is always caused by right heart failure or whole heart failure. Do you know the reason for the systemic circulation congestion in right heart failure? Yeah? Tell me. Blood. Our karma.
now?
Decrease the blood return to heart.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And how other reasons?
Hmm?
CVP.
Central venous pressure increase.
Yeah.
The same answer. Because the CVP increase, so blood pressure, so the blood return to heart decrease, so leading to systemic circulation congestion. Another reason is when cardiac decrease, so RAI system RAS system is activity, so more sodium and calcium result, right? So blood volume increase, right? Yeah. Another reason that you said the pump function decrease, so ventricular I don't know diastolic period ventricular I don't know diastolic blood volume increase so right atrium pressure increase so block venous return to heart so leading to systemic circulation. A circulatory congestion. There are a lot of symptoms caused by congestion or systemic circulation, such as venous congestion, increased venous pressure, and so on. So you may find jugular venous engorgement. Can I see the picture? That's some of the blood.
Okay.
This is abnormal feeling of the jugular vein, right? You can see that? Yeah. This is the classic sign for this is classic sign of the jugular venous hypertension caused by the venous congestion in right heart failure. Okay? Yeah. And you can find after jugular reflex sign. When you press the liver area of the patient with right heart failure, so the venous blood is bound to the circulation. So you can see the abnormal feeling of jugular vein. Okay? So this is hypertrojugular reflex sign. Yeah. Okay. You can find the congestion of a liver enlargement. The liver enlargement was caused by the obstruction of the inferior venous cava, resulting in the increased hepatic venous pressure and expansion, bleeding, and edema of hepatic sinusoid, which contribute to the hepatic enlargement. And the patient with right heart failure may present a lot of symptoms such as indigestion, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting. That's because the gastrointestinal tract function is impaired because of the blood congestion in systemic circulation.
Yeah.
Okay. And the patient may present cardiac edema. Cardiac edema is one of the most common symptoms in the patient with right heart failure. Here we still know the mechanism of the cardiac edema. What's the reason? The first is a lot of blood exists in the lower extremity. That's because the blood return to heart is blocked, right? So blood volume in the lower extremity is increased. So hydrostatic pressure in the lower extremity increase, which promote the edema formation, right?
Yeah,
the first reason. Another reason is reabsorption of sodium ion and water. That's because the activation of RAS system, right?
Yeah.
The third one is the patient with right heart failure may present a lot of symptoms of gastrointestinal tract, right? Yeah. So in the patient with right heart failure, digestive function disturbance and hepatic insufficiency leading to hypoproteinemia. We know a lot of protein are successes in liver, right? Yeah. So hepatic insufficiency decrease the synthesis of protein, right? And digestive function disturbance can inhibit the intake of protein, right? Yeah. So both of them can lead to hypoproteinemia. Hypoproteinemia is another reason for edema, right? Yeah. Okay. congestion of pulmonary circulation is always happening in the left heart failure. This part is very important. When you review this part, you should spend more time on this part. The patient with pulmonary circulation congestion may present dyspnea. Dyspnea with the difficulty of softness of breath. So you should know the reason for the dyspnea in left side heart failure. The first reason is pulmonary congestion and the edema can decrease the lung compliance, similar with the heart compliance. When lung compliance decreased, so lung compliance increase, the resistance of dilation of pulmonary artery anger increase. Yes, that. Need to repeat. information? No? Yes. Can you understand? Yes?
Okay.
So in this condition, the deletion of pulmonary alveolar will be restricted. So breathe is difficult. Another reason is congestion of pulmonary circulation can lead to mucosal congestion and swelling. So a lot of substrates can be secreted in the airway. So the resistance in the airway increase to further leading to the difficulty of breathing. The third reason is pulmonary capillary pressure increase of interstitial edema in lung can stimulate J receptor, then resulting rapid shallow breath. So the patient cannot breathe, right? Cannot breathe. I can't breathe, right? So this dyspnea, right? And according to the security of dyspnea, the dyspnea can be divided three kind of types, including dyspnea on exertion, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, and asopnea. So next lesson, I will introduce this type of dyspnea in detail. Okay. Okay. Pass over. Thank you.